tale you can tell. It's the one that they secretly long for. It must be unprovable, impossible, fantastical. To believe it, it then becomes an act of faith. An act of faith. Scene one, the train.
Are Crenshaw.
And Frank Adam Stein.
Okay. Ella. And one name will do, Frank. I'm going to throw you in at the deep end. Come on, fish all of making drama.
Just a yes.
Thank you, Derek. Yes. Yes to an idea. Yes to each other. Yes to the energy, to the communal experience. Yes to the mighty universal yes. That's what we aspire to in this world, isn't it?
No.
Okay, Frank. Let's start with you. I'm going to pick on the hot seat.
What for? To scold your ass.
The hot seat, guys, is a place of discovery. Now, we usually use it when we're in character, but I don't even have a thing to map that. I'm an instinctive teacher, and my instincts say, go, make go. So, we're going to throw away the code of good practice and hot seat you as yourself.
A psychological torture, Mint.
It's going to be fun, okay?
You can leave in permanently scarred.
Frank, the rest of the group will ask some questions.
You're infringing his human rights.
And your only job is to be truthful.
These are torture chamber conditions.
Oh, that is ridiculous. Frank, it's a simple question and answer exercise. Are you being tortured? Right. Think about everything that's brought you to this moment in time. People, when I clap my hands, we're going to begin. So have your questions for Frank ready.
Do you feel like in doing this, Mint is infringing your human rights?
What's your name?
I've already said it.
I wasn't listening.
Frank.
Frank what?
Stein.
What's that short for?
Franklin.
Your name's Franklin Stein. Are you lying?
My dad thought it was funny too. In fact, it was his last big job before his sense of humour calcified and had to be removed.
Are you a monster?
Probably.
You a wanker?
Great!
What school was you at before, Franklin?
I'm home educated.
What?
My mum and dad have been teaching me at home.
How long for?
Since I was a fetus.
You've never been to school?
Nope.
Why not?
Yeah, my parents are really.
No thanks.
Perhaps they thought that if I went to school I might turn out to be normal. So they concentrated all their efforts into turning me into a freak.
Why?
Well, they're freaks themselves, so they wanted me to fit in.
Okay, Frank. I can understand your defensiveness. Just try to be open. Say yes.
Well, to be fair to Mum and Dad, that's Tina and Jeff. They thought I could fulfill my potential. If I went to school and learned everything there is to know by the age of 16, I might turn out to be some kind of leader of men or a genius of some sort. But eventually I'd point out the flaw in their plan and say, Tina and Jeff, if you don't let me go to school, I'm going to end up in that house by the age of 20. And to drive home my point, I painted my walls black and drowned Tina's pot plants. So, given that I've got 4 A's in A-level already, they decided to let me come.
Did you say you were a genius?
No, I'm a great disappointment.
Are you gay?
Question not allowed.
Have you got any diseases?
Not allowed.
Have you got a girlfriend?
No.
Got any friends at all?
Well, if you mean actual living people. No.
That's sad, isn't it?
Okay, Frank. One final question. What made you choose drama?
Well, seems like the obvious choice, really, because it's pointless.
Okay. Well done. Respect. Round of applause.
Frank.
Yeah. I love you.
Okay, Eleanor, we're going to try something different with you. Are you ready?
Nope.
Learn to say yes. Okay, you barbarians, get off your chairs. I'm going to be in role as the interviewer, and I'm going to try and find out about the real Eleanor. And from what I've gleaned in this interview, you lot are going to act out episodes of Ella's True Life Story.
Bore me to death.
Someone's already beat me to it. I said, move your chairs.
That was great.
Move
on. I could never tell the truth about myself.
Why is that?
Because no one would believe it.
I would.
Welcome to Life Game. Today, we have our special guest, Eleanor Whitnishaw.
Yo!
And we are going to be recreating before a very own life episode of Ella's True Life Story. Now, take us
that your earliest childhood memory?
Yes.
I'm at the Sculpt after school. It's a rainy night. I'm in bed with two of my friends.
What sort of school was this?
It was a private orphanage. We had benefactors who paid our fees. It's hard to explain, really. Such places don't exist anymore.
When was this?
Must have been about 1812.
Okay, Eleanor. I think I can feel some improvising going on here, which, in a different exercise, would be totally cool. But since this exercise is about the real you, can we speak to the ship for now?
I'll try.
So share with us your earliest memory.
I have a clear memory of celebrating the Russian Napoleon in Russia. That's why I'm so sure it was 1812. It was night.
What were you doing in bed with two girls?
It was winter, and at night it was so cold.
Were you naked?
No.
What were your friends called?
Harriet and my teacher.
Okay. In the spirit of saying yes, we're going to go along with Alice's impro.
It's not an impro, it's a memory.
Point! You play Eleanor. Debit, you're Harriet. And Briggs, you're Letitia. I beg your pardon.
I'm not playing a girl.
This is 1812. How come you're not decomposed?
I freely confess that I've stayed alive for all these years by drinking human blood.
That's disgusting.
Oh my God, you fucking weirdo.
Are you saying you're a vampire?
Yes.
Eleanor, you know sometimes when we've been through a traumatic event like a parental divorce or bereavement, we retreat into fantasy to make sense of it all. Now, I'm not saying that that's wrong. You've had a sympathetic ear here, okay?
Oh, no, she hasn't. Mint? Is this supposed to be a drama lesson? Because this is like stepping into someone's mental breakdown.
Okay, right. Let's fast forward to the 21st century, to the here and now, and find out about the real Eleanor.
How many people have you drunk?
Do you suck anything other than blood?
Could you live with Eleanor?
Clay.
Who's Clay?
My legal guardian.
Oh, what about your mum and dad?
My father's a spirit, I never knew him.
And your mother?
My mother is a vampire. She's a mental emergency man.
Okay, Ella. One final question. What made you choose drama?
My hilarious sense of fun.
Scene three!
One thing's puzzling me, it's daytime.
Yes?
So, if you was a vampire, you'd be a little pile of dust by now. And I'm surprised you haven't cringed away from me shrieking.
Why's that?
Because Tina made me garlic sandwiches for lunch.
True vampires live in a society just like everyone else.
You haven't even got pointy teeth.
We don't die in daylight. We're not scared of garlic. We can use our teeth, but we prefer to let the blood in the night.
You don't look like you've committed countless motiveless killings.
I do have a motive. My own survival.
Make sure every blemish is removed. We need perfect specimens.
Eleanor, if you were really a vampire, why would you tell us?
I've carried the secret for so long. I thought, if I told someone, I don't know, would the walls come crashing down? You might have known that no one believed me. It was a mistake. No one usually notices me, and I put myself in
the sights. As we burn, we're going to observe the physiochemical alterations of the cell wall. What is the behaviour of the potato? Does it scream with pain?
Well, if it makes you feel better, I don't think I made any friends either. I bring out the worst in people. They can probably sense that there's something not quite right with me.
Let us meditate on the fate of the potato.
What's not right about you, Frank?
I see the world too clearly.
Do you?
This humble chamber will lead us to ponder the morals of the food chain.
It's all in fragments, but I see everything all the time. The beauty, the horror, the madness. The inescapable ride towards destruction. The machinations of far-off power. The monsters of...
Yes?
The terrible and ridiculous monsters of...
Yes?
Sorry, monsters of my own making, my own thoughts.
That's not what you're going to say.
No. I just think humanity can be a bit monstrous sometimes, that's all.
You think humanity's monstrous?
Well, not monstrous, just asleep maybe.
They happen, Frank. That's why they feel asleep, because they're happy.
How can you be happy in a world like this?
The subject of food is like a door, a metaphysical door opening between the worlds. The scientific, the political, the environmental, and yes, the spiritual. Gashnauts, today by peeling the foil in this potato, you will be taking your first steps into the new universe.
So where'd you keep your coffin anyway?
I've got
around
to burying me.
Maybe you need an appointment with the school shrink.
Me too.
1812, I'm 6 years old. At night, I sleep in a bed with two other abandoned girls. They are my friends, Letty and Harriet. One night, I wake in the dark to see a lovely woman in a shining dress. She's looking at me as if I'm something precious. Who are you, I said.
I'm your mother.
She replies, and I'm glad, because my mother is dead. Now I know she's an angel.
Scene 4.
Happy hour.
Such a laugh at her.
That's funny, because Eleanor's only in year 12.
Yeah.
So you're here underage drinking, aren't you, Dave?
No.
I take a very dim view of that.
How do?
Could lose my job for serving you.
Well, note I'm 18.
Show me some ID.
I haven't got any, because I look so mature.
Get out.
So you're saying get out, but then you've got your hand hanging to the back of my hand, so I can't actually leave. I'm getting mixed messages here. You smell lovely, by the way. What'd you say your name was again?
Claire.
Well, Claire, I know there's a bit of an age difference, but...
Are you going to give me some bullshit, Dave?
Let's go try, yeah.
About how you can prove you were all grown up by giving me a shag your lifetime.
It's going to be nicer than that.
Shall we cut to the chase?
Are you chasing me, Claire?
I'm always in the pursuit of pleasure, Dave. I like to live in the moment, in the eternal second and present time. Do you get me?
Yeah.
It's what I exist for. The present that I seek is random and indiscriminate, and when I find it, there's no guilt or consequence, just
patient in a moment of bliss.
Wow.
Do you consent?
To what?
To be my next pleasure.
I think that might be the best offer I've ever had.
Well, yes, then.
Don't mess about, do you?
Never.
Mistaking me for an idiot.
Then what will you accept?
Admit defeat. To go on is past reason.
My daughter is at a little school where she will marry and have a safe life. She's been told that her mother is dead, and the fiction will soon be true. In my profession, we don't last long, even as clever ones. My lungs are rotting by inches. I'm so angry, but I'm spitting blood.
I have something far more valuable than cash. Perhaps we should play for that.
What is it?
I have a secret.
Don't waste my time.
I am offering you time, sir. I know the place where you can find life everlasting.
I'm insulted.
No, Ruffin. I'm offering you immortality. Where is the insult in that?
Mortality?
You can move through time. Forever young.
How?
I was traveling through Asia Minor.
When?
Last spring. An old companion, a friend of mine, we were near Byzantium.
Constantinople, sure.
Byzantium, when he fell gravely ill.
What friend? His name, please.
I've sworn never to reveal his name.
And your story is full of holes.
We're up in the mountains when his fever heightened. And I knew that we wouldn't get back down. We came across a cemetery in a deserted ruin. There's a half-blasted statue of Artemis, the huntress. And then, in the midday sun, with the birds circling above us, I lay my friend down to die.
Our description are truly compelling.
He begged me for water! So I went to get some, and when I returned, there on a large rock was a bird with a snake writhing in his beak. He was looking at me. And I shouted a curse, and the bird, he spread his great wings up into the air and glided over the graves. My friend, I give him the water, and then I noticed on his neck was a mark, red and angry, like the two-pronged bite of a spider. My friend, he asked for water. A miracle, he whispered. With the last of his strength, he made me vow never to tell him of his death, an oath I am breaking to you now. At the end of the month, he said, when the moon rose...
What a fabulous tale, but this is too fantastic.
Oh, you don't deserve my secret. The thought of bestowing this precious gift on you, you'd waste it. I'd be better off offering it to this girl. Be a fine thing, don't you think, to have an immortal whore? She can wreak vengeance on mankind forevermore.
And what happened to your friend?
My friend died.
He whispered the secret and died. Perfect.
I held him until he was as cold as the rock he lay on.
And then what?
I dug his grave. The bird watched as I worked, haunched on the statue like a silhouette. In the shadows, his shape seemed to take on the shape of a human. And I buried him. Ran through the night, stumbling through the dark. And in the morning, I came across a coast and a town. There I lay for a month, hallucinating, terrifying terrors. I sent letters to Byzantium.
Constantinople, surely.
And then, on the day I was due to set sail, there on the harbour, I saw him, my friend. At first I thought it was a hallucination. Then he came and gripped me on the arm. And there was a shining in his eyes, like everything to him was wondrous. There was a cold burning about it.
A cold burning. Very nice.
He shook my hand and thanked me for his care. He was freezing.
I don't believe a word.
That's because you have no faith! You're longing for it to be true. Your fortune. And I will tell you everything. This is the location of the cemetery, the significance of the bird, and what befell my friend.
Where is your friend now?
Do we play?
We play.
I hardly did breathe. Hoping that the stranger was...
Hi. Oh, sorry, Anna, that scared you.
No.
What are you doing?
Drama course, Nick.
Oh, how's it going?
Fine, I'll put it away.
Mine's crap, I don't know what the hell he's talking about.
Who?
Greg. I mean, what's alienation anyway? Will you go out with me?
What?
Sorry. I just had my session with a shrink.
Oh.
Yeah, he wants to refer me.
To whom?
More shrinks. Have you seen him yet? Down the truth here is a bad mistake.
Thank you.
You know, I've been watching a lot of vampire films lately.
What's that?
Oh, you know, thought I might get to know you a bit better. I mean, they say some great stuff. When you get past the kicker, you start wondering what they're meant for. You know, it could be AIDS, heroin, anorexia. It could be the whole spiraling chaos of Western society, not knowing the difference. I mean, not knowing the terms. And they're sexy and heartbroken and mostly Californian. And they keep coming up with these great cliches like it's easier to succumb to the darkness within you than to fight the darkness without. I think that if it wasn't for the nihilistic disregard for human life, they'd be the closest things we got these days to gods.
Could you say that again?
They used to be there to terrify us, and the forces they represented had to be crushed by
righteousness. But they don't terrify us, they fascinate us. Perhaps we're all going to be vampires, I mean, in the way we devour everything. Did you see your reflection in the mirror, by the way?
Not properly, no.
That must be disturbing.
It was at first, but I'm used to it now.
I love your psychosis, Ella. It's epic, it's amazing.
You listen.
I'm having a party. Well, it's not really a party, I'm only inviting you. But it's my birthday, we've done.
Yes. Frank, I love the way you speak.
Do you?
So human. The great thing about being whole is that nobody knows you're there. I could have been furniture that night. The stranger lost. He forfeited his secret and fell right into my eavesdropping ear. Lord Riven soon departed for the East, and I told him if he took me with him, he would get my constant service free. By the time we reached Byzantium, my lungs were seeping blood. I just prayed I would live to see my daughter grow.
Scene 6.
Which African nation was known until recently as Zaire?
A pass!
Tina!
The Congo!
Oh, I'm sorry, it's the Democratic Republic of Congo.
Oh, thingy!
Which phenomenon causes the opposite weather conditions to El Nino?
Do you like Charmed or Tabella?
Thank you.
Ding dong!
Franklin!
La Nina.
Correct, 10 points. Name two languages of Eritrea.
Bath!
Tina!
Hibernia and Arabic.
Correct. One step closer to Chockies, Tina. If I was looking at a sprite, where would I be?
You'd be in the middle of a lightning storm above the clouds.
Well done, that was a hard one. Now, name me the debris deposited by a receding glacier.
Terminal moraine.
I'm sorry, strictly speaking, it's just moraine.
Oh.
You're given the point.
I was looking for the generic term.
Given the points, Jeff.
Oh, I can't give it a push. Didn't buzz. You've got to buzz, Eleanor.
Do you like pink peach off? Franklin only gets them for very special treats.
Dad, will you please give Ella the points?
Look, I'm the quiz master.
You're being unfair.
It doesn't matter.
Yes, it does.
And anyway, she didn't follow the rules. I can't give her points unless she follows the rules.
Go on, the yummy.
No, thank you.
Right, name three different...
Right, I'm not playing.
Franklin, we've bought these shots especially. We spent time and effort compiling a question list. We do a geography quiz every year because you like it.
Well, I'm 17.
And we've taken that into account with our choice of questions. Now, pull yourself together and give me three different kinds of igneous rock.
Oh, pumice!
Buzz, Tina, buzz! Tina!
Shut up now, or I'll sway.
Dej,
I don't want to do a geography quiz. I don't want beach hearts. And I don't want you or Tina at my party!
Franklin, how can you say that?
We have done everything right.
Oh, not this again.
We could have had fulfilling adult lives, careers, holidays, but no. We exhausted ourselves ensuring your development. You had the reading age of 12 by the time you were 6. And one day, you'll realise what that meant.
It meant I was alone!
Let's go for all the people, Frank. My building is going to bloom.
Yes.
And the mint, then we brought a screen.
Ella's a vampire.
Are you?
Yes.
And she's been alive for over 200 years.
Have you?
Yes.
I thought there was something about you, some whiff of depression. Ha, I know it is. You're an anorexic.
No.
I've got no patience with anorexics. I think you're rude and freakish. What's wrong with food?
Come on.
Come in.
Wherever you're going, young lady, whatever starvation-induced visions you may be having, don't take our son down with you.
She won't even eat peaches, Franklin. She'll embrace his death. Keep away from her.
Scene 7.
Embracing death.
They weren't an awfulness, but Hark, I'm not really surprised. They didn't want to ask. I think it was Nirvana.
Am I embracing death?
That was my best party yet.
I feel alive.
amazing? What if it's the best thing ever?
I have to go.
Where?
Back to Clay.
I'll come.
You can't.
Why?
You won't like her.
So?
She won't like you.
Why?
She'll tell you lies. She'll try and tell you that I'm only 16 and that they can trace our useless sperm of a father, so they put me in a care home. She'll tell you I got raped there. How she found me all withdrawn and suicidal. How she fought for me, rescued me, breathed her life force into me. Since then, she's been my mother. She'll tell you how we go from town to town and wanting social workers and police. How she sticks at low-paid jobs because they give her the opportunity to steal. She'll tell you how a magpie heart is satisfied by simple little pleasures. And so it is. My sister mother is ruthless, Frank. And so am I.
You're not ruthless.
I'm telling you the truth. Why don't you believe me? Who's this then? This is Frank. He's my friend.
You're what?
Hi, I'm Frank. You must be Clay. I hear you're really good at identity theft and shoplifting.
They've called me into your school. Why would that be?
I suppose it's because someone tried to put a stick through my heart.
Get indoors now. And send it back home.
You better go.
Why?
Because Clay doesn't like you.
So?
Frank, I don't want to hurt you.
You wouldn't hurt me even if you tried.
Scene 8.
Kiss me.
Scene 8.
So vampires do it in this.
Scene 8.
Costume cupboard. You can call me Claire.
Thank you so much for coming, Claire.
This is a nice classroom.
It's a drama studio.
Lovely.
Yeah. What's this over here?
The costume cupboard.
Oh, I like dressing up, don't you?
Claire, these are just like the real thing.
How long have you had salt out ballerina for?
Since I was legally able. When our mother died 3 years ago, she got put into a care home. I got her out of there as soon as I could. She's been with me ever since.
That's a great responsibility. So
they were monsters in that care home. I couldn't have just left her there.
Well, respect.
Sorry, what was your name again?
The kids like to call me Mint.
You've got very nice hands, Mint.
Thank you.
Can't help but noticing. Very elegant fingers.
I'm sorry that I had to call you in.
What's she been up to, Mint?
It's hard to know where to start.
Because usually she's fine at school. Usually I don't need to bother.
As part of their coursework, the kids had to write a short scene. Most kids just do little monologues, but Ellen has written the best parts of plays. Which is great, don't get me wrong.
A play? Isn't she clever?
The reason I've called you in is the subject matter. Eleanor is quite convinced that she's a vampire.
What?
Yes, and not only that, she says that you're one too.
I'm sorry.
She rarely talks about anything else. She says that you're not really her sister at all. She says that you're a mother.
A vampire mother.
She says that you were a 19th century cooker.
She never did.
And that you became a vampire when she was just 6 years old. You look everlasting.
Unbelievable.
What are you looking at?
Nothing, my lord.
Are you laughing at me?
I wouldn't dare.
It's a really amazing story. I'm giving her an A. She's got you following some lord to a ruined cemetery near Constantinople.
I have searched every rock and stone in this godforsaken ruin. And no revelation has come. He lied to me. The secret isn't here.
You don't see it, do you?
Why are you laughing? What did he tell you? Where is it? You know how to get it, don't you? You better tell me, or by God, you'll regret it.
And he becomes totally incensed.
If you make a fool of me, I swear I will kill you.
And he strikes you, very violent, quite disturbing, actually. In your recent states, he kills you.
Eternal life will only come to those prepared to die.
Then die!
He locks you into the tomb and leaves you to carry on. By the time the next full moon rises, he's preparing to set sail, and you find
born, reanimate, immortal. You wake with a terrible face and set out to find Lord River. You find him in the hotel room with a girl he's paid to entertain him.
My lord.
You're cold.
I'm burning.
You realise that the worst fate for him would be to die of all the sexually transmitted diseases he picked up over the years.
Your own corruption will kill you. You'll never be mortal, but this girl will.
And you kill and drink an innocent prostitute right in front of him, just to show it how powerful you are.
I never do that. I never kill an innocent.
Eleanor's natural indiscriminate.
She must hate me.
But you show no mercy.
Mint, I'm stunned.
Can we come out of the cupboard now, please?
How could she write about me like that?
The trouble is, the vampire delusion is so carefully maintained and so convincing that the others have completely rejected her. It doesn't help that the kid recently disappeared. Kid 14, Fritz? Ran away from home, you think?
They what?
Fritz. Do you know him?
Never came across him.
Eleanor had taken an active dislike to him. Now the others are accusing him of harbour and outlandish crime.
What have you done with him?
Where's Fritz?
You freak!
Don't lie to us, you blood-sucking bitch! Where's he gone?
He never disappeared like that.
He was too boring.
And we were in love.
So tell us where he is before we put that stake through your heart.
Stop!
Look, you check the sock out of her mouth. She might be able to talk. Otherwise, it's just mindless torture, and I'm a member of Amnesty, so I'm a bit uncomfortable with this.
Such a pussy. Where's Briggs?
You have no idea how I'm trying not to heal my powers. Not a technique boils to make a bloodbath of your flesh. You have no idea how self-control and godlike compassion I'm exercising.
That is so pathetic.
What did you do to Briggs?
Nothing!
He was beautiful.
He was an idiot! Just the kind of consenting whore I would love to have killed. But I didn't.
Where is he?
There's a very real possibility that he just ran away. You know how much he wanted to be interesting.
He never would have left without me. We had dreams. We were going to live in a van and write songs about meaningful sex.
I wish I'd clung to his prey. I wish I'd gorged on his every last corpse.
I didn't.
Something terrible's happened to him.
You're going to pick us off one by one, aren't you? Unless we finish you first, mutant stinker.
Watch our eggs 200 years
from deeper comes before our eyes.
Her scream will recounter.
I'm freaking out! I'm freaking out! I don't know what to do! We need a teacher!
Bring her back in!
I want violence! Violence! We climbed her outside the staff room, still to our eyes in the trolley. There was a wooden stage shoved down in Cardi.
I've tried so hard to be a mentor and a sister.
I'm sure you've done everything you could.
She's my whole life, Mint.
Look, I've been speaking to the head teacher and to the counsellor. They're keen to refer her to psychiatric services.
They're not sending her to shrinks, they might split us up.
Maybe a short stay in the
room. No way!
Look, we're very sympathetic here, but Eleanor needs more help than this school can currently offer.
Mint, they may try to take her away from me, and my heart will break right here.
What are you doing? Let go of me, Claire.
You want to help me, Mint. I know you do. Look at me.
I made the decision a long time ago that relationships, feelings, human interaction, these things would only happen in the theatre for me. Real emotion does not come near the wild spectacle of being on the stage. I live for creating drama. It's made up my life.
You must be so alone.
No. Anything can come out of this. Any character, any marvellous scene. I've been happy to wear down my health in service of the theatre.
You're so devoted.
Yes. And the pinnacle of my achievement is A-level drama. It sustains me every year. Claire, the worst part about all of this, about your sister's breakdown, about Briggs' disappearance, the traumatising bullying, do you know the worst thing?
What is it?
That the kids are refusing to work together. They're saying no. Please try to understand.
I'll try.
If I don't let Eleanor out of my class, the rest of the group are going to get bad marks in their practicals. They might even get D's.
My heart bleeds for you. It really does.
Scene 9.
Education.
3rd of January, 1822. The Love Diary. And your clean white pages. They're like sheets in which my lonely thoughts can lie. Today, I'm 16.
16?
Perhaps I'll prick my finger on a spinning wheel and die.
Letitia and Harriet enter.
Emma, there's a gentleman to see you!
A gentleman in our school?
A gentleman?
He said...
I'm here for Miss Webb.
For you! For you! I got to take this jacket.
And as he gave it to me, he said...
Thank you, child.
And if my lion, miniature lion, running up my arm. Who is he?
Lord River.
Lord River? But I don't know him. I've never heard of him.
Miss Goldpepper led him into the library. She asked him the purpose of his visit, and he said...
I have news of her mother.
And then Miss Goldpepper tried to question him, and he just sent her away.
Bring her to me now.
He wants to see you alone.
Alone? We're so jealous.
We're so jealous. He has news of my mother?
He touched me. Right there.
My mother is dead.
See his jacket?
The best tailoring, just the best. Smell it. You can't.
It smells of tobacco. Her faint smell.
Can't smell it. No, you don't. You'll be able to tell.
It smells of metal.
Did you see his boots?
Spattered with mud from his manly life.
My mother is dead. Why is he here?
It must be something dreadfully evil. His expression, it was graver.
Dark and brooding.
As though he's prey to some cureless inquietude of mind.
Some what?
Inquietude. He looks dangerous.
All men look dangerous when you ask. We've never seen any men.
He seems somehow delighted to
me. Like a poor, wounded beast.
Full of dark mystery.
Oh, stop it!
When he touched me, it was like lightning, I felt. I'll never be the same again!
My lord, I'm Eleanor Webb.
Eleanor Webb? Look at you. I know your mother.
My mother is dead, my lord.
Nonsense. I have been searching for her this past decade. Ever since she stole my secret. And last week, I found her. She's living not 2 miles from here. And she is doing what she does best.
My lord?
Keeping a brothel. A dunghill, a kennel, a whorehouse. Do you understand me, child? Your mother sells human flesh.
Stop right here! No! Stop now!
And she preys on her customers like a carrion crow and picks them off one by one.
You know what, Ed? Please stop!
I don't understand you. My mother is dead.
I don't understand you. My mother is dead.
Is that what they've told you?
Don't make me go on!
My dear, they have nourished you on lies.
What do you mean?
I'll be brief with you, Miss Whipple. Your mother stole something from me. And I will steal something from her.
Let me go.
Imagine my delight when I discovered that you existed. Her precious, treasured daughter. The jewel she has kept hidden away all these years.
My mother is dead!
Your mother believes that the pact of blood that she made with the gods and monsters makes her invincible. I will cause her pain. I will make her rage as I once raged when she stole my secret!
Don't touch me!
I am dying, Miss Webb. I could have lived forever. I will soon be dead. Your mother robbed him, and I will rob you. You will share my disease.
Mother!
A terrible disease for an innocent to catch. And when I am finished with you.
Mother!
What are you doing, Ella? I've just been to see your teacher. personality disorder on your notes, I'll throw away the key. I'm fed up of trying to save you.
Suppose I don't want to be saved.
Is this your play?
Yes.
How dare you?
Eleanor, where are you, your mother?
My mother is dead, my lord.
Damned in carrion crow.
I don't understand.
Nourished on life.
Let me go.
A secret.
Mother!
Disease.
Mother!
And when I'm finished with you.
Very clever. What comes next?
Can't write it.
A rape scene without a rape. Why are you calling your brother?
Welcome to the adult world. Welcome, Miss Webb. Welcome to a slow death. Welcome, you whore. Give my regards to your mother.
Eleanor, he didn't kill you.
I'm still dying.
He didn't kill me. I'm dying.
Why are you laughing? Ring.
Get packing.
Why?
We have to go.
What have you done, Mother?
Don't call me that. I'm your sister.
What have you done?
Nothing!
And I'm not going.
We have to.
Why?
Because you're right. This place is killing you. You're going small-town crazy. We'll go to London, wherever you like.
I want to stay here.
Why?
Because the magnolias are blooming, and the bins are in forest green.
Where did you last eat?
What's that got to do with anything?
When did you last feed yourself? You're so unique, Ella, you're so amazing. When are you going to start living?
Look at you, you're starving.
Scene 10.
Happy! In order to do my proper duty to you, as a full technology teacher, I have been trying to teach you every edible thing on this planet. We've gone into Earth, and we've come back bearing fruits.
I'm leaving Tina and Jeff. Come to London with me.
Can't.
Yes, you can.
We've spent many weeks delving into the vegetables, and now we must encounter the beast.
We can get crap jobs in the night. You can just lie there.
A new herding. Meat.
Thinking up ways to attack the consumer system.
Frankenstein! This lesson may bring you learning that will affect the rest of your life. I want you young people to leave my classroom secure in the knowledge that if society breaks down or the supermarkets close, that you could walk into a field, butcher an animal, and prepare enough food for a tiny village for a week.
Have you heard about mint?
What? I'm harking back to a pure time where we didn't consume meat in plastic from a factory. I'm harking back to a time where we stroked and petted every animal we ate.
Found dead at the doornail in the costume cupboard.
No. Who meant? If we killed it, we respected it.
They're trying to tell us it was a script.
No. I'm going to teach you to respect the beast. So in one day, when chaos and violence break out and starving people are roaming the land, that you could hold up your meat cleaver and say, I did it, A-level food technology. I can save humanity. So today, as of tomorrow, we're going to start by investigating the beast life source. We're going to make blood pudding. Onions finely chopped, 1 kilo diced pork fat, 2 meters of intestine, 1 liter of double cream, oatmeal, salt, barley and mace. And here is our pig's blood. Pig's blood is identical to human's blood by 98%. Isn't that a strange fact that we're 2% different than a pig? Mint is dead! My comrade! Your teacher's bullet!
sight is at the end of the land stand. But for now, think of this. God, why did you only make us 2% different from a pig? I'm sorry. I'm a wreck this morning. I love mint. Mint was an innocent. Normally, you have gallons of fresh blood from a mature beast. But for today, I just have two. Now, the blood is set and when it's full, what are you doing?
Forgive me.
Don't do it!
Stop it!
Give up!
Oh, my God!
It's fair!
Hurry!
Shake him, Brick!
Shake him, Brick!
Fire!
Darvell.
What do you want?
I'm a doctor.
kind doctor?
Kind that seeks to heal.
Do I know you?
I want to help you.
Can I have a pen and paper?
In time, you should have everything that you want.
I need to finish my story.
Of course you do.
It's about a girl. She needs a boy. He's a genius. But every bit as bright as she. She's been alone for a long time. The boy tries to save her. Her past is gone. Presenthood. She has no future. She is the beetle who crawled into amber.
What do you mean?
I'm hungry all of the time, yet I cannot eat. My desires are destructive. I'm alone. I'm a vampire! Do you believe me?
I don't know what madness is. There's only pain and our ability to bear pain. Sometimes the pain becomes too much and the mind breaks.
When we devour, it's because of our nature.
Perhaps. But our natures can change. Change can be painful. It can feel like a mortal blow.
It hurts.
All pain can be relieved.
I feel immortal soon, but not alive. She's 16! She's a 16-year-old kid! You can't legally set her, she's too young!
And in order to help her, she has to come with me.
Elna, he's from a secure institution. Don't go with him, there's nothing wrong with him.
Listen, you tank top desperado, you've got no right to be here and nothing to say. This situation is none of your business.
Yes, it is.
I'm her legal guardian, she's mine.
Eleanor is free to come with me.
Mother!
My girl!
I'm not your mother.
Please, don't leave me.
I have nothing else. Frank!
I want nothing from you.
You're under my protection.
Frank!
Come on!
No! Through here!
This isn't the exit.
I know. Shut the door.
Now, why didn't you run for the exit?
I live in here. It could be anything you like.
Come to London.
We'll protest.
Yes.
Against what?
Ella, unless we protest, unless we stop devouring ourselves. In 200 years, there'll be nothing. We must protest, even if our only word is no.
Frank, I'm writing a vampire story.
I know, but it's just a story. It's not real. You're real.
Frank,
you can't have a vampire story.
You can't have a vampire story.
Unless
there are vampires in it.
I'm sorry.
I'm so sorry.
Don't be sorry.
Scene 30.
Byzantia.
Good morning, Eleanor.
I finished my story, Doctor.
That's good news.
I've done it all night, right through the darkness.
I look forward to read it. You have a wonderful flair.
Thank you.
You've been up here long enough. Perhaps you'd like to come down? Your sister is going to visit you.
My mother?
Your sister. Did you forget? Perhaps you would try to eat something for her today? And maybe you'd like to try on some new clothes. What would you choose, Eleanor?
I'd like some of my costume, please.